Right, I think we'll make a start. We've nearly got everybody in now. Just good morning to you all. A very warm welcome to you. It's great to see you all here. And we especially welcome anybody who may be visiting us this morning. I've got Rob Hopkins pointing to something. Are things all right?
I've just realised the screens aren't on.
Oh, the screens aren't on. Okay, we'll deal with that.
The power is on.
So today, anyway, we're going to continue our One Another series. And we've already thought what it means to love one another, to serve one another, and to be united with one another. And today we're moving on, and we're going to study and think about what it means to encourage one another. And we look forward to hearing Tristan speak on this later on this morning. Encouragement, of course, is absolutely vital to everybody's ministry, each one of us. So we look forward to learning something there and to enhancing our encouragement skills. Is that up now?
Not yet. On our way.
It's done. That's great. Thank you. Right, so if we'll now begin our service proper. And I'll start by saying, grace, mercy and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day the Lord has made. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day, keeping us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do always what is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're now going to say the creed, the Nicene Creed together. I think it would be good to stand for this, if that's all right. So we all stand for that. So we say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. So we now pray our prayer of confession. We say together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. I think now we're going to have a worship song. Unfortunately, only one person can sing, but we will silently be worshipping and praising God.
This song is "Come, Now is the Time to Worship," and it says, "Now is the time to give your heart." So worship is involved in giving your heart, not just your voice. So I would encourage you to give your hearts to worship as I sing. Sorry, thank you, Audrey.
Reading this morning is from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning at the 19th verse. A call to persevere in faith. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we receive the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him, he said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." And again, "The Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Remember those earlier days, after you've received the light, when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property, because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Cool. I'm going to put this here. And I just wondered, as we speak this message, I just wondered if we could just take some time out to pray for the person next to you. So look who's next to you. You don't need to move in your place, but just look who's next to you. And let's just pray for them. Pray that the Lord would speak to them today. And pray for your brother or sister. Pray that they may be encouraged. Pray that if they need some healing in the word of God today, sanctification, and pray for the Lord to do that. But let's just have a minute just for you to pray for one another. Heavenly Father, thank you that you want to speak to each of us today. Thank you that you have given us your word and that your word is truth. So we just pray, Father, under the Lordship of Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit come here now and speak to us directly, individually, and as a church body. We pray this, Father, that we, your children, and the body of Christ may become united in service to God, and that you will be glorified. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Awesome. Well, it's really good to, this is our penultimate Sunday working here, and I think just before I continue, it's just amazing to have this opportunity to speak this morning and to encourage one another, and what an amazing time it has been for Sarah and I and even Ariane in these last 2 years. We will be here next Sunday just to say sort of more of a goodbye, but thank you so much for this time. It's been really good and we've been truly blessed, and so it's just so great to be with you again this morning. So this is Encourage One Another, and this is the week four of our sermon. So we've done Love One Another. Does anyone remember the second one? Serve one another. Last week's one?
Unity.
Be united for one another. And today is encourage one another. And so I guess, as this is my leaving message, may this be the final encouragement. Amen. So what does it mean to encourage one another? Now, I think, generally speaking, we can think affirmation and comfort is the sort of direct understanding of encouragement. You know, well done, mate, you did really well then. You know, well done. Or, it's all right, you know, things will be okay. That is a type of encouragement, absolutely. But it's not the main sort of weight of encouragement. We're looking at something higher and meatier. And actually, the greater understanding, don't get me wrong, affirmation and comfort is a form of encouragement, but we're looking at admonish one another. which means to warn one another and to plead with one another, to encourage. I encourage you greatly, sort of thing, to plead with. And also that can come with a bit of a challenge. And I, you know, when people thank me, be like, oh, yeah, well done, sort of thing, I was like, oh, thank you. But when I'm challenged, that really encourages me. I'm encouraged with the challenge. And actually, we had a great warning in our reading this morning. It said, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire. That encourages me to make sure that I don't get stuck in sin. It's a warning, but it's encouraging. I've been moved forward to stay away from that. You know that I was in the army, and we did a lot of running, particularly with heavy logs. And you know, when you're on the race, and you know, the finish line is coming up, and you're really exhausted by this point, it's good that someone comes and encourages you. And so they'll come beside you and be like, "Come on, mate! You know, you're nearly there. This is the last stretch. Really put your weight in. Come on, man! Come on!" And it's encouraging. So I've got to strive forward for the last bit. In a similar way, if you saw someone sleepwalking in pitch black and they're just about to walk off a cliff, you need to encourage them to not walk off the cliff. And that's not going to be very sort of, "Oh, mate, there's a cliff. Wake up, there's a cliff." So you've got to encourage them to turn around. And I think what's good about that is we can notice that the person who does the encouraging in both circumstances has vision for what lies ahead. In the race, the encourager has the vision of the finish line. You're almost there. This is the last stretch. Ready, put your all in now. They can see. And on the cliff, the encourager sees what lies ahead, the cliff. So if we are not aware of the finish line or the danger that lies ahead, then we won't be great encouragers. And even the world understands this, because the common term is, "No, don't worry, mate, everything will be okay," thinking that they can see ahead. Encouragers are people who speak into the present because they have vision of what lies ahead. And that vision, by the way, needs to be true and not made up. And so we all of us, need to be encouraged. We need to be encouraged to love one another. We need to be encouraged to serve one another. We need to even be encouraged to encourage one another. So, you know, if you wanted to encourage you need to be encouraged before encouraging. And actually, how are you going to be encouraged is by seeing what lies ahead, the vision. For example, at the end of the race, they're walking off a cliff. So with that in mind, let's look at our passage today. It was a big call to perseverance, a big, mighty passage. And I just read it in your own time as well. It's itself encouraging. But the bit of the text that we'll focus on are verses 24 and 25. Can you put that on the screen, please? Thank you. "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." The writer of Hebrews is encouraging the church to spur one another on toward love and good deeds. The writer is encouraging them to meet together. He is encouraging them to encourage one another because he sees what lies ahead. What lies ahead? "And all the more as you see the day approaching." He has his vision on the day approaching, the day of the Lord. And the day of the Lord is not the reason to love one another. It's not the reason to meet or to encourage, but it's the encouragement to do these things because of the day of the Lord. So this is our encouragement. This is the church's encouragement. We must have our eyes fixed on the return of Christ, the rapture of the church, the raising of the dead, the final judgment, the prize. Paul writes, forget what is behind and strain towards what is ahead. Press on towards the goal to win the prize in which God has called you heavenwards in Christ Jesus. And this day that's approaching is not out of sight for us. 2,000 years ago, it was even within their sight. They can see the day approaching. So the early church perceived just how close it was, and it encouraged them to encourage one another. And the day of the Lord even encouraged them to love one another. Romans 13, verses 8 to 12. If you love your neighbor, you will fulfill the requirements of God's law. For the commandments say you must not commit adultery, you must not murder, you must not steal, you must not covet. These and other such commandments are summed up in this one commandment: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to others, so love fulfills the requirements of God's law. Then listen to what it says. This is all the more urgent, for you know how late it is. Time is running out. Wake up, for our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is almost gone. The day of salvation will soon be here. So remove your dark deeds like dirty clothes and put on the shining armor of right living. Again, here, the direction, the command is to love one another. But the encouragement to do so is the day of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. So fixing our eyes on the Lord's return is the church's vision of what lies ahead. It is its encouragement. It's where we get our encouragement from. The Lord, but the day. So we should ask ourselves, why should the Lord's return encourage me to encourage others? What is it about the Lord's return that should encourage me to encourage others? Because the first time Jesus came 2,000 years ago, he came to save the world. And the next time he's coming, he's not coming to save the world, he's coming to judge the world. There is one thing that we will all, every person in the world will have to face one day, and that is judgment. For the Christian, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, we will be raptured and meet with Jesus in the clouds. Once our corruptible and mortal bodies will become incorruptible, immortal, and glorified bodies. And what a moment that will be when we meet with our Saviour, Jesus, in the clouds, in that moment, glorified with him. In 1 John 3, it says, dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. It's a glorifying moment. But following this meeting with Jesus, every Christian will then have to come before the judgment seat of Christ, judged not for our sin that has been dealt with. We have been forgiven by his blood. But we shall be judged by Jesus for our works and how we used the gifts he gave us. And this judgment is called the Bema Seat of Christ. And that comes from the Greek way in which in a stadium with athletes, the Bema Seat was where they received their awards. It's a reward-giving ceremony. And there's a podium and a great amount of onlookers watching every athlete to receive their due rewards for what they have done. And we will be judged for what we have done, both good and bad. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 9 to 11, so we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in a body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Since then we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade others. And for some Christians, this will be a great joy and celebration. We long to have that meeting with Jesus where he judges us and he says the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." But we must also be aware that for some Christians, it won't be so joyful. To some, he will say, "You wicked and slothful servant, take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. And this is better explained in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 to 15. It says, "For no one can lay any foundation other than the one we already have, Jesus Christ. Anyone who builds on that foundation may use a variety of materials. On one hand, gold, silver, and jewels. On the other hand, wood, hay, and straw. But on Judgment Day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. If the work survives, that builder will receive a reward. But if the work is burned up, the builder will suffer great loss. The builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames." And when I've meditated on this, that has made me be like, I've got to check myself. I've got to check what I'm doing. It actually encourages me. Am I relying on the Lord or my own strength? Are my motives right? Is my heart right? Is my love for God genuine? And this is why we are to spur one another on toward loving good deeds, encouraging one another. I find this also interesting that you can see God's what God really cares about. God cares about quality, not so much quantity. Because we can have a quantity, we can appear before the judgment seat of Christ with loads of works of wood and hay and straw, and they will all be burned up. But the quality of the service to produce gold, silver, and jewels will last. Do we know any Christians who are deliberately sinning? They may be on a cliff edge, and we need to encourage them. To encourage them. We need to warn them because we love them and we know what lies ahead. In our reading, it said this morning, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire. We have got to help each other. If we ourselves even are stuck in sin, don't keep it to yourself. It's not worth it. Confess it even to your brothers and sisters. Seek help. Seek prayer ministry rather than judgment. Prayer ministry, by the way, isn't so much about if you've got a bad leg, pray for healing. They will do that. But actually, it's about praying to the spirit and into the soul where we have trouble, anger, fear, disbelief even, but they all pray for you that we may be more sanctified for the coming of the Lord. We have to watch out for one another. So that's the judgment for the believer, but how about for the unbeliever? Jesus and the apostles speak so much about this. And have we, I don't think I have we really grasped what happens to those who reject Christ in this life on that day of judgment? Have we really understood the eternal fires that God has? Our hearts should ache for the lost because God's heart aches for the lost. God says it's his will that none should perish. God doesn't want anyone to perish, but that all come to repentance. Let's remind ourselves a little bit about that day of judgment. It's important to do so. Revelation chapter 20. I'm reading from a book written by Amir Safati, who's an Israeli Christian, titled The Day Approaching, funnily enough. He speaks on Revelation 20. I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And then the author writes, this will be a somber and tragic day. At this point, all those who have rejected God from Cain through to the end will stand before this judicial king. They will finally understand the depths of their rebellion. They'll recognize the heinous nature of their sins. They will realize the righteousness of the Lord's justice as it is meted out to them. And they will wail in sorrow as they are cast into the lake of fire for all eternity. It is painful to even write about this. People I know, people I love, will face the judgment, the Lord, at this judgment. I can close my eyes and picture the terrified and remorseful looks in their faces as they hear this verdict pronounced. I can't bring myself to take that next step of visualizing them cast to their just punishment. Friend, let this be a motivator for you to strive to live and speak the gospel to all those around you, even if people reject or mock you because of your boldness. Isn't that a small price to pay for the chance that you might play a part in rescuing them from this final judgment? The time is short. We must be about our Father's business. That's encouraging. So why should the Lord's return encourage me to encourage others? Because judgment is coming. For the believer first, our eternal rewards and prizes are given to us, and we should all desire eternal rewards for us and others. And for the unbeliever, we should desire that they be saved from the wrath of God that is yet to come. This is why we should be encouraged to not give up meeting together. This is why we should be encouraged to pray earnestly for the lost. And there is a monthly prayer meeting starting next month, which Andy introduced last week. This is an opportunity to pray. To pray, pray, pray. Pray earnestly for the lost and for the strengthening of the worldwide church. Pray that God will give us the boldness and the power to proclaim Christ, because judgment is at the door. A bit of a shift. Is it good for us to be looking and focusing on the second coming of Jesus? Is it something that we should be doing? And a question for us all that I just want us to ponder on briefly is, I'd like us all just to imagine in our minds now, if there was a united belief in St. Andrew's and Milton Coombe, what if we all believed, certain that Christ was coming back in the next 10 years? Do you think we would be doing the same thing that we would be doing? I'm not sure myself. If I believed that Christ was coming back in the next 10 years, and I knew that you all did as well, let's meet and pray. Day and night, night and day, let's earnestly pray for the lost. Guys, there's no time. People's lives are at stake. Let's do it. Let's proclaim the gospel every day. Come on. Let's make sure that ourselves, that we're ready to meet with our Saviour, to meet with our Judge. Am I holy? Do I live pure and holy lives? Do my brothers and sisters in the same way, how much more can I help them? I don't live for myself anymore. The kingdom is coming. You know that I'm leaving, and next week, today is the day that Sarah and I are leaving the house, and so we're tidying up and packing stuff. And about 3 weeks ago, my landlord very randomly was like, I've got to come fix your dishwasher, or whatever it was. And we're like, okay, when? He's like, I'll come in about an hour's time. Okay, quick, tidy the house. Wipe the mould off the walls. Quick, he's coming, the landlord's coming. I wasn't quite ready, but knowing his soon return, I had to quickly clean my house up. You could ask Tristan, how could we know that the Lord might return in our lifetime? The early church thought that. They were convinced of it. 2,000 years ago, they were well off. No one knows the day or hour apart from the Father. It's true. But we can see the signs. The Lord made that clear. We must have our eyes on his coming and recognize the signs. The early church apostles were convinced that the Lord was coming back in their lifetime. Is it wrong that we could be as convinced as they? Can I have the image of the fruit tree? This is a fruit tree. It has roots, a trunk, branches and fruit. And the Bible says, if the roots are holy, the branches are holy. Jesus says, good tree bears good fruit, a bad tree bears bad fruit. And what we see here is that the beliefs are the roots, the values, trunk, and it springs out into the action. So basically what it's saying, what you believe will affect your actions. What you really believe will affect your actions. And so what we believe about the second coming will determine the fruit that we grow. Jesus speaks in Mark 13, 34 to 37, of how our posture should be for his return. It is like a man going on a journey who left his house, put each servant in charge of his own task, and instructed the doorkeeper to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the master of the house will return, whether in the evening, at midnight, when the rooster crows, or in the morning. Otherwise, he may arrive without notice and find you sleeping. And what I say to you, I say to everyone. Keep watch. Remember the tree. If you believed that it was highly likely that the Lord would return soon, 2010, 20, 30 years, if we believed that, we would keep watch. Jesus just said, keep watch, believing that our belief system would say, well, he's going to come soon. Jesus wants us to believe he is returning soon. But no one can make ourselves believe. It's a revelation of the Holy Spirit, and we have to ask him to reveal it to us through Scripture. Paul speaks in 2 Timothy 4:8, "And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing." We are to eagerly look forward to his coming. Philippians 3:20, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ." As this great day is the church's encouragement, let us seek it. 2 Peter 3:11 to 12, "Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming." There is a stirring, a wake-up call to the church across the nations. I love working for Flame International because I get to go to the nations and be in Zoom prayer meetings with people in South Sudan and Armenia. And there is a united call, there is a united wake-up call. Keep your eyes on above, not on things on the earth. What is the Lord doing? Where are we in these days? We are to watch and pray, watch and pray. Let's focus on this day approaching. As I said, we cannot come to an understanding ourselves. We have to ask the Lord to help us. This is the encouragement that together, let's be asking the Lord to help us to know more about this day. Ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. So study Scripture and read what different authors and theologians have to say about it. Ask God even for visions and dreams because it's biblical. Joel's prophecy says, "In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams." Three promises for the last days, which we are still living in. Prophecy, visions, and dreams. So eagerly seek them, so that you and one another will be better prepared for the day of the Lord. And this is a little extra, by the way, I didn't need to put it in, but if you're really serious about wanting to encourage one another, excellent. If we're really serious about wanting to grow in encouraging one another, then seek the gift of prophecy. 1 Corinthians 14, the word of God says, "Eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. The one who prophesies strengthens others, encourages them, and comforts them." So if we want to strengthen and encourage one another, seek the gift of prophecy. And there may be some misunderstanding, maybe some doubt about prophecy, but just a word of caution. Doubt leads to disbelief, and disbelief leads to disobedience. Let's not doubt the gift of prophecy, otherwise we'll be disobedient to the word of God and not seek it. The Bible commands to eagerly seek the gift of the Spirit, especially prophecy. And it's interesting that even the very nature of the second coming is prophetic. It's prophecy. Hallelujah. So I'm going to finish now the concluding statement, the take-home message. And please take it home and speak about it amongst family, amongst ourselves. Be brewing this up, because this is the encouragement that the Lord wants to give us. Listen here. A church that is encouraged by the Lord's return and all that it holds will be encouraged to pray together, to spread the gospel together, to not give up meeting together, to encourage one another to live pure and holy lives and to love one another. Fix our eyes on the coming of the Lord Jesus, the day soon approaching. Amen, and let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you, God, that you have stored for us a path of righteousness, a path of growth, a path that is filled with your desires and your wills for your kingdom to come, a path that is in line of loving one another and serving one another and being united and encouraging and praying for another. The Lord, you want us to walk in this way, and I thank you. I thank you that that's your will, and I thank you that you give us encouragement. But Lord, we know that in ourselves we cannot do it. We must have you. You are the great encourager, the Lord of hosts, the Holy Spirit. And so we ask, Father, that in the name of Jesus, you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, Lord, that we may greater know of the coming day of the Lord and all that it holds, and that from there we would be encouraged in love to watch out for each other and to keep watch on you. Lord, help us to give us the gift of prophecy that we may encourage one another, Lord, for your kingdom glory, that your body will be built up and strengthened. Father, this is for you and the glory of our Lord Jesus. Bless us, therefore, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Bless you.
Thank you very much for those words and that message, Tristan. So we're now going to continue our own silent praise and worship of our wonderful God, led by Caroline and Audrey.
There is a day that all creation's waiting.
Let us pray. The writer to the Hebrews wrote in chapter 10, verse 39, "But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." Loving Father, we thank you for your love and for your faithfulness. We thank you that we can rest secure in the safety of your loving and saving grace. Help us as we encourage one another, and help us to have faith to move out with courage, knowing that in your power alone we are made strong, and that your love will never fail us. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray for our nation and for the Queen. We give thanks for her strong Christian faith and example. We pray for all who are concerned for their future and for that of their families. We pray for those who face the possibility of unemployment. We pray for our leaders and pray that they may seek first God's kingdom and righteousness. We give thanks for those who care more for justice than for gain. And we pray for all who seek to bring the love of God to those in need. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray for all students who just had the results of exams. We pray for their future, especially those in our church family. We pray for St Andrew's School and for all the new head teacher who will be starting in January 2021. We pray for Andy Bowden and Andy Farmer as they continue to lead us and to reach out with God's love to so many in our parish. We pray for Matt and to Becky Dillingham as they continue to serve with MAF in Chad. We pray for their protection and for the protection of those who work with them in their team. We pray for Tristan and Sarah and give thanks for them, for their ministry to us and with our young people. And we pray for their protection as they leave us in the near future. Lord Jesus, we pray for all who work with students. We pray that all young people may be guided by the Holy Spirit into all truth, and understand, as we've heard this morning, that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. May they consecrate their lives to your service and find in you the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. We pray for all who are sick, and in a time of quiet, we remember them before God. Pray that those who are sick may find the healing touch of the Lord Jesus, relieves their sufferings and brings them healing, and we pray in his name. Amen. Holy Spirit of God, from whom alone flows the fullness of life, come in your everlasting power into the hearts of us, your people, that we may find a new birth of holiness, a new understanding of truth, and a new unity in love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'd say the Our Father to Disciples prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Andy Farmer will now end our service with a blessing.
Thank you, Tristan, for your message this morning. I think I'm still going to be thinking about it way into next week, so thank you for that. So many things for us to think about. And I guess for me there's a couple of things that come out of that. One is encouragement from others, and that encouragement can be affirmation or challenge, and I think it's important that we accept that if somebody's challenging us in a godly way because they know what's best for us, then we should accept that as an encouragement as well. And that's certainly one of the things I've taken from this morning. So thank you for that. Thank you, Tristan. And the other thing is about hope. I think it's really easy to forget sometimes when everything is around us what hope we have because Jesus has died for us. And in 1 Peter, there's a strong emphasis on that hope. And that's what each one of us walks away with in our heart, is the hope that we have through knowing and loving Jesus, because he loved us first. I have the blessing now, which I will read out, but some encouragement that somebody gave me was that I sometimes say, I'm just going to finish with the blessing. Well, that can mean different things to many people. And reflecting on it, we're not finishing with the blessing, we're beginning with the blessing. Because we're beginning with this blessing to face whatever's in front of us in the coming days. So whilst it might feel like the end of this service, it's the beginning of the service that we have in the coming week. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.